Good noon, all of you. I hope all of you are doing fine. I am Nikita, your VRC mentor. I welcome you to Grade Up. And today we are beginning a new series, right? So this is the must know series, okay? And the purpose of this series is how to make RC passages easier for yourself, right? So while I have been discussing comprehension, retention, all these skills on the app these days, I thought that there is also a lot of vocabulary that is genre specific and that troubles students. So why not start a series on that genre specific vocabulary? That is what we'll be doing in this series, right? Good noon, Prathmesh. So before we proceed, I want you to note down your YouTube schedule, right? 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. every day. Note it down. You meet me at 12 p.m. every day on YouTube from Tuesday to Saturday. Right. And do subscribe to our Grade Up channel so that you can receive the updates and notifications of all of these sessions. Okay. If you like the session today, I hope it will be an insightful session, although you'll have to listen to me a lot and attentively. So then do press the like button. Share it with anybody who wants to enhance their knowledge. There is nothing management specific. There is nothing entrance specific about today's session. It's just that you get RCs from different genres. So that's why we'll do vocabulary from different genres in this series over multiple sessions, right? So share it with your friends. And in case you have any queries left after we are done with the session, you can post that in the comment section. Okay. Good noon, Pooja, Lionheart, Sharat. Good noon. All right. So the first word that I've written here, something that's very common, something that all of you have heard, is capitalism. Okay. So tell me, what is your understanding of this word, capitalism? Hi, Rohit. Something that's very, very prevalent in our society today, right? So I think all of us have studied this in our social studies in school, right? That it's a system of social, political, and economic organization. Yes, we have talked about capitalist economies. We've talked about socialist economies. So let's see, what exactly is capitalism, right? Good noon. Okay. So it fully depends on the private sector. So basically, yes, the means of ownership, they are private. Right. So basically the private owners, the private players, they own various resources. Okay. They would own machineries. They would own factories. Why would they own these? They would own these because they want to earn profit. Right. So profit is the motive. There is private ownership. And instead of the government, instead of the state here means the government. So rather than the state, it's the private owners who own various resources. Okay. Now, it wasn't that capitalism is the oldest form of economic and political system. No, there were other systems before this, right? For instance, feudalism. So feudalism preceded capitalism. So earlier, what used to be the case? There used to be kings and queens. Yes. Now these kings and queens, they couldn't rule over these huge pieces of land that they used to have, right? So they used to appoint members of nobility. Nobility were these people who were born in high class. Basically, nobility was the high class, and these were wealthy individuals. These were highly educated individuals. So what they said was, they asked these members of nobility that, you know, why don't you rule over our lands on our behalf? On our behalf. Please do so. Okay, so we will give you these pieces of land, and in return, you give us your military service. So provide us your military service. So nobility provided military service, and in return, they got these pieces of land from kings and queens. Okay. So therefore, by getting these pieces of land, they became feudal lords. They became feudal lords. If their pieces of land were again too big for them, they further appointed tenants for them. And these tenants further appointed peasants under them to grow the land, sow the land, keep a share of the produce and give the rest to them. Okay, these tenants and the feudal lords in return promised that we'll take care of you. Okay, so you promise your allegiance to us, we'll take care of you. So this is the system that preceded capitalism. Okay. And of course, there was a lot of exploitation in this system. There was a huge have and have nots divide under this system, because of which we needed another system and capitalism came. Right. But capitalism also came in with its own flaws. Right. Okay. So you have a lot of queries here. Let me just address these. I am good, Aditya. How are you? Right. Getting notifications of the live lectures. Have you pressed the bell icon, Siddhant? If you press the bell icon, that's when you get these notifications. Okay. Okay, Ravi, I'll try to speak in Hindi as much as I can, but I can't promise to speak completely in Hindi. That will defeat the purpose of our verbal ability sessions. Right? You'll have to read the passage in English. Okay. Then. Laissez faire. Yes, absolutely, Aditya. I'm coming to laissez faire. No, Aditya. Sachin, we are on our first slide. Okay. So, what is laissez faire economy? Yes, we use this term. So, basically, literally, it means let you do what you want to. Right? Let you do or leave alone. That is the meaning of laissez faire. So, a laissez-faire economy is an economy where there is no government interference at all in the economic affairs. Okay, in fact, in the government interference is kept to the minimum in political and economic spheres, and private individuals, they are given unrestrained freedom. So, this is a pure form of capitalism, laissez-faire economy. You would not see it in any country today. Pure capitalism, pure socialism, you would not see this in any country today. Okay, so capitalism has its own share of problems. We'll see what those problems are, right? Right now, this is what you need to remember. And why am I doing? See, there is a rationale behind each and every term that I'm teaching you today. So in CAT 2020 itself, in a para-jumble question, while capitalism has come time and again as part of RC passages also, so I wanted to show you the latest source. In 2020 itself, we talked something about this. See, economists and technologists believe that a new kind of capitalism is being created, different from industrial capitalism, as was merchant capitalism. So here we get to know that, okay, capitalism also had subtypes, industrial, merchant, right? The names actually clarify the term. Industrial capitalism, when you know industries, factories, etc. are owned by private owners, private individuals. Okay. Then merchant capitalism was basically concerned with trading. When you simply move goods from where they are cheaper to where they are expensive, and that's how you earn profit in between. That is merchant capitalism. So this is mainly concerned about production. This is mainly concerned about trade. Right? So in case you already know what capitalism is, okay, you are able to associate it with industrial revolution, you would have understood this sentence easily. Okay, so you would have been able to guess what merchant capitalism would mean, that it has something to do with trading. But essentially, you need to know what capitalism is. That is when these things will become easier for you. Okay. In fact, the problem arises when we have a passage that talks about all these terms that contrasts, let's say, capitalism with socialism and communism. So that's when we need to be clear about their meanings. Okay. So any query that you have about it? Hanji, any query that you have about capitalism? Okay, then. Let's see the next one. Good afternoon, Sita. Socialism. So our second term for the day, socialism. So you will tell me its meaning. Socialism. Yes. What is this? Again, you've read this in school. In socialism, so in capitalism, it is the private owners that own these resources. Yes, they own factories, they own machines, they own pieces of land, right? But in socialism, Yes, Ashar. We'll be so tomorrow itself we have another session, okay? And then from Wednesday again we'll have another session. So yes, this week, next week, they are for these sessions. The must-know words for various genres. Today it's politics. Tomorrow, let me tell you which genre we are going to talk about. I'll tell you later, okay? I have to recall this, right? So socialism, yes. Who will tell me what socialism is? Socially acceptable. Okay, the importance is given to social equality. Okay, all right. So basically, in capitalism, it was the private owners. Here, the belief is that the community as a whole should own the resources. Okay, not just one individual. That's the belief. So it's a political and economic theory. Again, it's both political and it, of course, extends to economic spheres. And here we say that the means of production, not just production, but also distribution. So industrial, merchant, all of it is covered. Exchange, all of those should be owned by the community as a whole. Right? Look around you. If there's a park in your vicinity, right? Whom does this park belong to? Not to any one individual. All of you pay taxes, or your parents pay taxes, right? And from the taxpayers' money, this park is built. So actually, it belongs to everybody. Yes? So this is an example of socialism in practice. So socialism says that these resources should be owned by the community as a whole. Now, it's very difficult to actually cooperate when the community is very large, to organize things when the community is very large. And that is why we need a government. That is why a government is needed. The government acts on the community's behalf, on the people's behalf. So this is not the government's park. This is your park, right? This is the people's park. So the government merely acts on people's behalf, okay, so as to ease all of these difficulties that may arise because of the community being too large. Okay, this government ensures equitable distribution of resources, right? Now, I said equitable. I didn't say equal. What's the difference between the two? Yes. Equitable, equal. A cooperative society. Yes. Absolutely. So it's organized on a socialistic principle, Suraj. Okay. So now, equal, it means that, let's say, all of our shoe sizes would be different, right? Of course, some of us could have a common size, but they are different. So if today I buy the shoes of the size 5 and distribute to all of you, would they be of use to you? No. So we do not need equality in every matter. We need equity, which is fairness. When I buy the shoe size that you need and give you that, ensure that everybody gets the shoe size that they need, that is equity. That's the difference between equality and equity. So in socialism, we try that there is an equitable distribution of resources, right? Again, socialism has its own problems. So in capitalism, there is a lot of profit. Profit is the god there, right? So that's why problems arise. The problems could be of greed, huge inequalities, right? In socialism, there's centralization because the government is managing everything. So there could be problems of corruption. So each philosophy would have some problems or the other. And you would not find any philosophy being implemented in its pure form. So in a pure form of socialism, it is the government that controls everything. From the food that you get to the clothes that you wear, everything. That is the government is the one that is in charge of distributing all of these. All the companies would be owned by the government. That would be pure socialism. So you would not find pure socialism anywhere in the world today. Right? Now, this is socialism, and our economy, the Indian economy, as you must know, it's a mixed economy. It's a mixed economy, right? It operates on both the principles, socialism and capitalism, right? That's why it's called a mixed economy. Now, I have written something like in Marxist theory here. What is this Marxist theory? What is Marxism? Yes. Good afternoon, Nikita. So we'll talk about Marxism and communism also in detail. Right, Marxism and communism in detail. In fact, in the very next slide, I'm going to talk to you about these two. Now, in Marxism, they think that this is a transitional social state. It's a transitional state between capitalism and communism. It's a transitional state, socialism. So I'll tell you how in the very next slide, right? Socialism is something that predates Marxism. It predates Karl Marx's philosophy, political philosophy that we know as Marxism, right? So that's why I've written it predates Communist Manifesto, a manifesto that was written by Karl Marx. And I've also written this here that it's a left-wing school of economic thought because I wanted to discuss this with you. What is left-wing? What is right-wing? You must have heard these terms very often in politics. It's a right-wing party. Okay, the left did not agree on this. What do we mean by all of that? Left-wing, right-wing, and who are centrist? Who are centrists? Yes. So, a poll is there in your chat box. Okay, socialism means, I've just explained that, Aman. I'll explain it again. Let's just discuss left wing, right wing first. So, see, the term actually originates before the French Revolution. So, before the French Revolution, the ruler at that time had become. Some people felt that he had become very tyrannical, very dictatorial, right? And they were fed up of him. So, a meeting was organized, and in the king's court, people who supported him sat on his right, people who did not support him sat on his left. Okay, so people who wanted a revolution to happen, they sat on his left, and people who believed in the order of the king, they sat on his right. From there come these terms right wing, left wing, and the one in the center in between is called a centrist. Okay, so left wing parties or a left wing ideology, a leftist ideology, it means that you are someone who supports egalitarianism, which means equality, equity in this world. Right, you support egalitarianism. You are anti-hierarchy. You don't support hierarchies as such. You believe that it's through revolutions, protests, etc., that the oppressed can actually claim their rights. So you believe in labor rights. That's when you are left wing. Right wing, on the other hand, they believe in social hierarchies. They believe in order in the society. They tend to be more conservative. They want to protect the old order. Conservatives are those people who want to protect the old order. Right? So these people are right wing. Okay. Centrists, they lie somewhere in between. Not completely leftist, not completely rightist. So, various political parties in India, they also have these ideologies, left wing, right wing, etc. For instance, there's this party called CPIM, Communist Party of India, Marxist. That is a left wing political party, right? When we talk about extreme right wing groups, for instance, some people say Bajrang Dal is an extreme right wing group. So even organizations can be extremely right wing. So these people believe a lot in rules, in order, and anybody who tries to defy that order, they don't like that, right? So Bajrang Dal, Shiv Sena, they are called extremely right wing. Okay. All right. Congress called itself centrist to the left. Congress, when it was formed, it called itself centrist to the left. Okay? All right. So I hope with this you've got a sense of this. This word, these words, these terms are used a lot in the newspapers and you should know what they mean. Okay? So socialism is a left-wing school of economic thought while capitalism is towards the right. Capitalism inclines towards the right. Okay? Now, I have also given you some instances where your passages in CAT, they have used these terms. Okay, I didn't remember the year for this one, So there was a whole passage that you got on socialism once. Okay, it was about two kinds of socialists. There were types of socialists who were more moderate, they were milder, and there were other who were revolutionary. So basically they were discussed in this passage. Then last year itself, you had a passage on anarchy. Anarchy is again a political ideology, a political philosophy. Okay, we'll talk about anarchy also. So you had a passage on this, and it said, anarchy differs from state socialism in opposing the concept of any central authority. Okay, so in socialism, we say that we need the government, we need the state, we need that authority. Whereas anarchy says there shouldn't be any central authority. That is what anarchy says, no central authority. Okay, any query in socialism, you can ask me. The basic concept, I think all of us know from our childhood, yes? Just that we are learning something more about it. It's a left-wing school of economic thought. It's a transitional state. I'll talk to you about that transitional state now. Okay. Communism. Communism. Even if someone does not know anything about it, the name itself appears related to community. So probably the focus will be on community and not on the individual. In that sense, it opposes capitalism, right? The focus is on community. So actually, communism is one of the most controversial political philosophies of our times. Okay. And it's very broad. There are a lot of schools of thought inside it. The most popular, the most prominent one being Marxism, right? Which was given by Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels, right? So what communism says, it is actually an ideal that we strive towards. Communism is an ideal that we strive towards. It says that all property should be owned by all the community. The entire community should own all the property. And Karl Marx proposed this, that how should the resources be distributed? See, everyone should work according to his or her ability. Everyone should contribute to the society according to his or her ability. And everyone should receive according to his or her needs. That is what he said. He envisaged a world where people would work to the best of their ability, because he had a notion about work also, how work should be organized, what kind of work everybody, basically he was not in favor of the specialization that has happened today, right? So work ka nature hi aisa ho gaya tha, that it would give pleasure to the individual, it would give happiness to the individual, and therefore everybody would contribute to the best of their ability. That's what he believed in. That's what he theorized, right? So communism has a number of schools under it, Marxism being the most popular. Otherwise, Lenin has also contributed to it. Mao Zedong has also contributed to it, right? So we have something called Marxist, Leninist, Maoist communism, right? So it's a very broad philosophy. Essentially, what is the core of it? Let me explain that. So Karl Marx said, Thank you, Varsha. I was actually afraid that some of you might find it boring because I am the one talking, but it's actually refreshing to see that you are also enjoying it. Okay. And these are things that I have also learned in the course of teaching, because I am not a politics student as such, but when I read such things, when I taught such things, that's when I learned about them. So I thought, why not make it clear to all of you? Right. So what I was saying was that Karl Marx, he was born in, he basically grew up in England. Okay. So now he saw that there were huge inequalities in England, right? There was mass exploitation of labor, right? The working conditions were pathetic, even for women and children. So at that time, the society was a capitalistic society. So capitalism was resulting in this exploitation where the owners were exploiting the labor class, right? So when he saw this exploitation, he felt that, you know, this model is not sustainable. Till how long can you exploit an oppressed group? Someday or the other, it is bound to revolt. Someday or the other, it is bound to revolt. So Karl Marx envisaged a revolution by the labor class against this owner class. He used to call the labor class proletariat. Proletariat, the labor class. And the owner class was called बूजवासी, इट्स प्रोनाउंस्ड एज बूजवासी, दिस इज द स्पेलिंग. ओके, सो ही सेड दैट वन डे द प्रोलेटारियट विल रिवोल्ट अगेंस्ट द बूजवासी. फॉर दिस दे नीड टू यूनाइट देमसेल्व्स, फॉर दिस दे नीड टू बिकम अ यूनियन, unite themselves. So that's why he his one of his popular slogans is workers of the world unite. Okay, so he said that one day they'll be united, they will stage a revolution and they will overthrow capitalists. Okay, they will take the ownership from the capitalists, and gradually what they will do, they will proceed towards socialism. They will proceed towards socialism where there will be collective ownership, but there will be a government that will basically distribute those resources on our behalf, right? And ultimately, people will become so adept, so skilled at this production and distribution, collective production, collective distribution, that they will not even need a government. There will be no owner class, no labor class, there will be no government. We will have a stateless, classless society. That was the ultimate goal. And that is when we would have communism. Okay, this is what will lead to a communist society. In that sense, no country today is a communist country, in this sense, as Marx envisaged. Okay, because every country has a government, right? So this was Marx's vision. And he was one of the major contributors. Later on, some people accepted some thoughts of his, rejected other thoughts of his, incorporated some of their own thoughts. For instance, Lenin did that, right? Then some of them actually made it very radical and turned it into a dictatorial regime altogether. Mao Zedong is an example of that, right? So you can read about these people more. It will be difficult for me to cover all of them here. Okay, so I have explained all these points to you. The class struggle between workers and capital class. The capitalists are essentially exploitative. Okay, this would create a class conflict which will lead to a revolution, right? So that is why Marx thought, that is why, you know, communists believe that socialism is nothing but a transitional state. It's a transitional social state between the overthrow of capitalism and the realization of communism. Right? So this is about communism. Why am I doing this? Okay, first is that it's a very popular philosophy. You should know about it. Secondly, time and again, particularly in one year, you had a whole passage on communism, which was taken from a Guardian article. Is communism dead? That was the title of the article, if I'm not wrong. And it was actually a tricky RC passage. If you didn't know these terms, communism, totalitarianism, colonialism, fascism, we'll look at all these terms. If you didn't know them, it would have been difficult for you to actually comprehend it. Okay. Central wing, Prathamesh is asking. So central wing is when you are partly, you take some ideas of the left, you believe in some ideologies of the right. So let's say I believe in labor rights, but I'm also not completely, let's say, communist. Okay, I think I need some form of capitalism or the other. Then in that case, I have taken some ideas from the left wing, some from the right wing. I am a centrist, right? In centrism also, I could lean towards the left or I could lean towards the right. Okay, so no, Maoists are those who basically follow Mao Zedong's ideals. Now, Mao Zedong also borrowed from Marx. So it's not like they exist in isolation. Mao has also borrowed from Marx's ideas and incorporated some of his own ideas there. Okay? All right. So, Taliban is communist. Who is saying this? That Taliban is communist. Taliban is a totalitarian regime. Okay? In fact, it's a terrorist group, if you ask me. Not even a regime. So yes, this is a sentence from that passage. 15 years after communism was officially pronounced dead, its specter, its ghost, seems once again to be haunting Europe. That is how it began. Okay, it was a whole RC passage. Now, totalitarianism. Yes. Totalitarianism. What does the word suggest to you? Totalitarianism. What kind of a regime would it be? A very liberal regime? that gives total freedom. Swapnil is saying China. I would refrain from calling it totalitarian. Although, of course, some people believe that. I would refrain from doing that. North Korea is a totalitarian state. Okay, you should read, you should watch more about North Korea. I'll suggest you some documentaries also towards the end. The dictator is a humorous take on it, yes. So, total control, total and absolute control. That is what a totalitarian regime does. There is extreme social and economic regimentation. Regimentation means everybody will behave in the same manner as directed. Okay, people have, there is utter disregard for human rights. Okay, the dictator is the whole soul of the country, right? So that is a totalitarian regime. Centralized, dictatorial, complete subordination to the state. The individual is secondary, the state, the country is the, or the government, in fact, the ruler is the prime. Okay. And you see human rights violations in such countries time and again. Now, you know, in North Korea, there are some specific types of haircuts that you can get. Only some specific types of haircuts are allowed. That is the level of control that they have on people's lives. Okay. So, there are these two documentaries, I've written them later on also, that you can watch that feature North Korea as well. Dictator's Rulebook and How to Become a Tyrant. Dictator's Rulebook and How to Become a Tyrant. I think How to Become a Tyrant is there on Netflix. Dictator's Rulebook, I think this also I saw on Netflix. I don't remember now. North Korea has managed to achieve what other dictators haven't managed to. Because see, what happens is, the dictator rules, but when the dictator dies, it's not like his son succeeds him. That usually does not happen, unless of course we are talking about a monarchy, a king sort of a regime, right? Empire hai, monarchy hai, usme possible aisa. But North Korea has managed this, that once the dictator died, his son became the ruler. Now his son is ruling. So they have managed this continuation that other dictatorial regimes haven't managed. So these documentaries will tell you how they have managed it. Okay, what kind of cult they have created. Okay, so yes, this was there in a para summary. Okay, totalitarianism is not always operated by diktat, by official decrees, official rules. There was a para summary question last year itself, CAT 2020. Last year itself, it was there, I think, right? And of course, in your RC passages, it keeps on featuring time and again. Okay, all right. Led by an autocratic ruler. Who is a tyrant? Yes, who is a tyrant? Tyrant, dictator, autocrat, they all mean the same. These are synonyms. Okay? All right. Okay, so now let's talk about some totalitarian regimes that existed in the past. Okay, again, you will find it very, very interesting when you watch about them or when you read about them, right? So, fascism. Who is the name associated with fascism? Quickly tell me. With Nazism, we have Hitler, right? With fascism, who is associated? Tell me. You heard the name of Mussolini, Benito Mussolini, the Italian ruler. So he was the one who actually coined this term. Benito Mussolini. Where did he borrow this term from? In the Italian language, fasces stands for a bundle of rods. A bundle of rods. These are a bundle of wooden rods that have an axe in between them. Right? A bundle of rods with axe in between them. That is called a fasces. And it's actually a symbol of punitive or penal authority. Authority that can punish you. Authority that can punish you. From there comes the term fascism. Right? And during his regime, during his rule, again, there was an absolute control over the people of Italy. The state was basically all the features that we've talked about in totalitarianism. No, you will find them. You'll find them. You'll see them in fascism. Okay. So he rose to power a few years before Hitler, right? And extreme militaristic nationalism. He wanted to invade every other country. He waged wars in so many countries. He wanted to invade every other country. And ultimately, you know, because of this war obsession of his, he was voted out by his own people. His own people means his grand council of politicians. They voted him out of power because they thought that aise to bilkul economically, we'll be nowhere if we keep on waging so many wars. Wars involve so much expenses, right? So ultimately, he was voted out. So, he did not like electoral democracy. Okay, he was against liberalism of any sort, any kind. Okay, he believed in a strict hierarchy. Okay, and of course, the nation was prime. The individual came later. Okay. Is Lenin also fascist? See, fascism as a term is thrown around very loosely today. It is thrown around loosely. So, you will find a lot of use of this term in the newspapers. Let's say somebody has given a rule that you do not agree with. Let's say your school principal, college principal, he says something that you find to be oppressive. So some students might say, you know, that's such a fascist policy, that's such a fascist rule. So people throw it very loosely today. So the question that you're asking is Lenin also fascist? Some people might call him fascist, but no, he wasn't fascist as per his political ideologies. As per his political ideologies, he was a communist. Okay. Yes, he had an expansionist mentality. Very good, VM. So this is called an expansionist mentality when you just want to extend your influence and power to other countries, when you just want to wage wars and have control over other countries. Absolutely. Yes, it's a strong, it's an extremely right-wing rule. Okay? Correct. Good. You are contributing. Now, Nazism, I think everybody knows about this. Where does this term come from? Nazism. Tell me, Nazism. Actually, this is National Socialism. That was the term. In German language, you probably spelt it like this. Social, instead of a C, there was a Z. Okay, so it was a Nationalist Socialist Party. Okay, and the political ideologies, the principles of that party, Nationalist Socialist Party in Germany, that is what came to be known as Nazism. Okay, of course, Adolf Hitler is the face of Nazism, is the pioneer of Nazism. He was heavily influenced by Mussolini and he borrowed a lot of elements from there. There's a lot of misconception that Mussolini was inspired by Hitler, because Hitler went so far beyond the atrocities that were perpetuated by Mussolini. Usse bhi itna aage chala gaya ki sabko laga ki Mussolini inspired hoga. But actually, mein Hitler inspired tha. The Hitler salute, the Hail Hitler, that is also inspired by the fascist salute. Right? So, Nationalist Socialist German Workers' Party, that was the name of the political party. Right? It extended from 1933 to 1945, this Nazism, okay, and then Hitler lost World War II, right, he killed himself. It was again, all the features that you would see in totalitarian regimes that were present, but the atrocities, the scale of atrocities, the level of atrocities, the amount of racism, in fascism you didn't see as much racism, but in Nazism was an extremely racist ideology, racist against all of us know Jews, right? Yes, do watch the Schindler's List. It's a great movie. It's slightly long, but it's based on a true story and it gives you an idea of the kind of atrocities that were perpetrated. Another one that I would suggest, Life is Beautiful. It's a French movie, okay? So you'll find its dubbed version. You'll have to hunt online, okay? You'll find its dubbed version, Life is Beautiful. It's heartbreaking. I mean, it's so positive, but at the end, it's like it just breaks your heart. You see the kind of atrocities, the living conditions in concentration camps, right? And yeah, so do read about it, and do you can watch these movies at least, if not read about them. Life is Beautiful, Schindler's List, The Boy in Striped Pajamas. Okay, Sophie's Choice. Oh God, Sophie's Choice. Just a second. And you might think that I am over dramatizing it, but once you watch it, you will realize. Right. So, the symbol of Nazism, yes, it was swastika. Yes. So, in Hindu culture, it's considered to be sacred. But there it actually became a symbol of terror, swastika. Basically, it symbolizes purity. And Hitler said that, you know, Aryans are the pure race. So Hitler saw swastika as a symbol of purity. But then what Nazism turned into, converted that swastika into a symbol of terror. Right? So, yeah. There was a lot of mass appeal that Hitler had. So he created a cult personality, a lot of charisma around himself. Right? And people actually admired him at that time, because if you were living in that time, no, if you were living in that Germany, probably you would not think there's anything wrong with Nazism. Of course, if you were not a Jew, right? So he was liked widely by people. There was a mass appeal that he carried. And of course, it was racist against the Jews. So all these atrocities that he perpetrated against the Jews, they are referred to as Holocaust. Okay, the Jewish genocide, the Jewish massacre, we refer to it through a lot of terms. Holocaust is one of them, right? So find out more about it, read more about it. The Diary of a Young Girl is one book that I can recommend to you. Sophie's Choice is also, I read it as a novel. So you can, instead of watching the movie, you could also read the novel. Right? Pajamas, the pants that you wear. Right. The Diary of a Young Girl. Yes, absolutely, Suraj. Okay. So this was about Nazism. Now, these two terms, colonialism, I think we are ultra familiar with colonialism. We ourselves were a colony, a British colony, right? And imperialism. So the two overlap. In colonialism, see what happened in India. The Britishers came to India. They settled also. A lot of them settled in India. So when you create a colony, you come to that country physically and you settle it. And you settle there, right? And then you exploit it economically. So, of course, there is going to be political control. There may be a forcible use of power, use of force basically, economic exploitation. All of those elements are present. Imperialism is a wider concept. There you may not go physically to that country. You may just send your army. That's it. You yourself are not going physically. Right? So you could say that colonialism is one of the ways to implement imperialism. Empire. The term comes from empire. It was for the first time used for Napoleonic Empire. Roman Empire. These were all empires. Right? So you could do it either by going to that country physically or just sending your military force or through some other means. Some other sort of, let's say, diplomatic force could be used. Right? So this is just to distinguish between the two. Otherwise, a lot of times they overlap. You will see the term British imperialism also being used, British colonialism also being used. Okay? Jewism is a religion. Okay, Judaism actually. That's a religion. Judaism is a religion, and they were a minority in Germany at that time. Okay, so see, Germany had lost the First World War also, right? And as a result, it was in deep debt. Okay, huge reparations. Read about this. So basically, I want you to read about World War I and II, causes and consequences, causes and consequences, because when you have that background, no, you will realize why Nazism became so popular with people. When there are economic troubles, no, everybody is looking at somebody to blame. And that somebody became Jews at that time. Right? So read about this. World War I, causes, consequences, and two, in case you want to read it in a very capsule form, brief form, there's this website called ThoughtCo. There you will find it in a capsule form. Okay? Right. And finally, what is anarchy? We had discussed it earlier as well. And last year, a whole passage on anarchy came. All of these terms that I've discussed so far, colonialism, imperialism, Nazism, fascism, totalitarianism, they were all present in this passage on communism that I talked to you about, right? So, yes, coming to anarchy, ana and archin. Ana is a negative prefix and archin means to rule. So that means it translates to no rule. Okay. So, two forms of anarchy are possible, peaceful anarchy and violent anarchy. Okay. Usually we see violent anarchies in various nations, various countries. When, let's say, there is a power vacuum, there is no government currently ruling. Okay. And therefore, there's a state of disorder. Yes, it's there's mob rule in a way. Some of you could say that. So a state of disorder due to absence or non-recognition of authority or other controlling systems. Right. So that is anarchy. So in the Arab world, particularly when this Arab revolution, Jasmine revolution, this happened, right, a few years back, some years back now, that's when in a number of countries, a power vacuum was temporarily created. In Egypt, I remember particularly. Okay, so Hosni Mubarak, his rule came to an end and there was a power vacuum because the two opposite parties, they were fighting who should come to power. So during that temporary phase, there was anarchy, right? So this is one definition, which is the disorder wala definition, mob rule wala definition. The other is just a concept. It's just on paper. We have never witnessed it in any country. When people become so evolved that they will not need any government to rule them, that political ideal, that is also anarchy, right? So absolute freedom of individual, that is what would happen in such a case. So your passage, the passage that utopia, yes, the Greek god is saying utopia. Utopia means something that cannot be achieved, something that's an ideal, but it cannot be achieved. So this definition is, yes, you are correct. It's a utopian definition. Okay. All right. So look at this. The word anarchy comes from the Greek anarchia, meaning contrary to authority. So no, this is negative and this means rule authority, contrary to authority or without a ruler, and was used in a derogatory sense until 1840. Until 1840, it had this meaning. It was used in a derogatory sense. When it was adopted by this person to describe his political and social ideology. So some people have actually advocated for anarchy. Perhaps they were tired of the tyranny, the dictatorship, etc. of rulers. Right? So VM, this question that you've asked is a pretty deep question. Actually, yes, a lot of religions, a lot of regimes, they discriminate against Jews. So Muslims also, somehow there is this Muslim-Jew rivalry that's there in some other communities also. So I don't know if all of these stem from the same cause or spontaneously different communities started this rivalry with Jews. But yes, you are right in saying that Jews have been discriminated against, have been killed by a number of communities, by a number of religions. Okay, you can search more about this, that if there is any one single root cause. I don't think there is. It's something that has happened spontaneously. Okay. That's the rivalry that they have with Christians, the Greek god. What you're saying, the rivalry with Christians and Muslims is because of the sharing of holy sites with them. Yes, that is there. But what about, let's say, other regions, other communities also? There also Jews have been discriminated against. Okay. All right. So I hope anarchy is clear to you. And, you know, whenever somebody goes against the government these days, people label him or her as an anarchist. So that's again a loose use of the term anarchist. When just because somebody has disobeyed one or two rules of the government, you call him or her an anarchist, that's a loose usage of the term. Right? So colonialism, imperialism, anarchy. And lastly, this is something a philosophy that I feel that all of you should know. That's why I included it. Again, you had an RC passage in CAT that was based entirely on social contract many years back. Okay, in early 2000s, you had a passage on this that talked about the social contract theory. So it's a theory that has been proposed. See, we saw two extreme sides today. Communism, where people do not need any government. Then totalitarianism, when government has absolute control. And we had some things in between. So social contract theory says that, you know, if we didn't have any government, let's imagine a society when there was no political association. They called this society, they called this condition state of nature. This is state of nature. Okay. Then people, through their natural reason, because for some people, the state of nature may result in unhappy outcomes. Okay, let's say crime prevails. People may have to live in fear all the time. Okay, that somebody will take away what they have. So this state of nature can result in unhappy outcomes for some people. And therefore, people using their reason, their cognitive faculties, they decided, okay, let us form a government. Okay, let us have a government and let us sacrifice some of our freedom for that security that this government is going to provide us. So a sort of an invisible contract exists between the citizens and the government, wherein the citizens sacrifice some of their freedoms so as the government can provide them protection. This is called a social contract. Okay, so in every society, this social contract exists. Okay, all of us are sacrificing some of our freedoms in return for the protection that the government is providing us. This theory, although it's very old, Socrates, as it runs as far back as Socrates, he proposed something like this. However, properly, it was formed in these centuries, and these three philosophers, Hobbes, Locke, and Rousseau, they're often named together, Hobbes, Locke, and Rousseau, they are credited with giving this theory. Right? So again, you can read more about this. It talks about something called a veil of ignorance, state of nature, natural reason, all of these terms. It has its own terminology. Right? Okay, let's see your queries if you have any. Yes, in CET also. See, it's not like CET is a very unique exam. It also picks up RC passages from various articles that are there, right? So last year, for instance, it had a passage from Economic and Political Weekly. It's a magazine that is known for its economic and political articles. So you can very well have an RC like that talks about political philosophy in CET. Okay. So yes, these were some of the terms that I felt that you must know. Of course, these are not the only terms. This is not an exhaustive list, but these are some must know terms, which you should know in general also, even if you're not preparing for any entrance exam. Right. Tomorrow again, I'll bring some words related to another genre. I think tomorrow it is philosophy. I am just not sure and I'm not able to see my schedule. So don't worry, we'll have, basically I've chosen those genres that appear frequently in your exams, right? So we'll meet again tomorrow with some more terms and I'll show you where they've been asked in your RC passages and we'll discuss them, right? Meanwhile, this is your homework. Yes, what is federalism? What is federalism? A question has been asked. Federal. When we have this country state structure, just like, you know, so US, for instance, the United States of America, there are multiple states there, no? So the power, some power has been delegated to each of these states. When we have this country state structure, even in India, so that structure, this which relies on the delegation of power between the country and state, where there is a sharing of power between the country and state, where the country is the prime and the states are subordinate, that is called federalism. Okay. All right. So yes, this is your homework. I'll see you again tomorrow. If you found value in the session, please like it. It took me a lot of time to make it, by the way. Okay. And yes. You'll find the link of all your subject-wise, exam-wise lectures at one place. Just check the description box. These are the batches that we have recently launched for CAT 22, non-CAT exams, and CAT 21. If you're interested in any of them, you can join them. For more information, you can speak to our counselors. Our super subscription, see, currently there's a sale going on it. Use the code TEACH25 Okay, use this code TEACH25 and you'll get a 25% off on the super subscription. Because Teacher's Day is coming, that's why we thought to start this sale. Right? Yes, this is a list of our faculty members. You know all of us. And these are the details of our super subscription plans. These are also available on our website. Do follow us on Telegram. Whenever any update of CET comes, we'll post it there. So don't worry about it. Okay, we will do, Suraj, this is the first session. This is the first session of this series. Hum economics based RCs ki bhi baat karenge. Business and economics, I've kept a whole session on that. Okay, so just keep attending. 12 p.m. on YT, you see me from Tuesday to Saturday. Okay, welcome. Thank you for attending. Bye.